hey, hey, hey. That's what I say.
You know, I always feel kind of dumb because, to me, it was just a riff I came up with and I gave it to Mick. He said, that's kind of, you know, we worked on it together for a day or two and then, but we didn't really think that much of it, you know, just knocking it around in a hotel room. And we had one more day left. Those are the days when you cut an album in 10 days. And we had one more day before we were back on the road again. And we were in L.A. I think it was Mick or I said, well, what about that little piece of trash we worked up?
I don't write consciously for autobiographical lyrics. I find them a rather hackneyed method. You know, break up with your wife and then you write a whole album about it. You know? I mean, it helps to get out of your system, I guess. But I think it's, you've got to merge imagination and experience. And the experience isn't only your own experience. You have to put yourself inside of other people's heads. And I mean, that's what you do. That's what, if you're a good actor, that's what you do. So you see two people having a fight at a bar, and you use their experience for your lyrics. So even though it's a real life experience, you might have been seeing it in the third person, but you put yourself in the frame of mind of the man. Or if you want, you can put yourself in the side of the woman. And you can write a song from a woman's point of view, and then perhaps you shouldn't sing it, you should give it to someone else to sing. But that's also fun in doing that. I haven't done that in a while, but it's always a good test.
So humble these days. Anybody can be wrong, you don't know, you know. I mean, we had Start Me Up in the can for 6 years before we found it and realized it went right by us when we cut it. Yeah. We just put it on tape and rubbish.
When I heard the Rolling Stones, I was just feeling I wish that was my music. I wish that I was doing that kind of music.
They were just a great group, great rock and roll group. I went to see them a few years ago now in New York, just one hot summer night. Mm. And they're a buzzing little group, you know.
So my history with the Rolling Stones goes back to the very early 60s. They were always an enigma to me.
Hey, I love that band. I still think, to me it's not a cliche, I still think they're the greatest rock and roll band in the world. They personify everything I liked about rock and roll.
I can't wait to see them. I'm a big fan of the Stones. I can't wait to see them.
Each year throws up its own character and its own stage show and feeling, and there's a sort of time capsule element of a tour, I think. You go to a show and you, I mean, I'll go to a show and say, well, I remember that was the year I went to see him or her, or that was that band, and where they were on the stage was like this, and I remember what they played.
Right, to work together, it was a real turn on this year. It just fell in straight away. Probably a lot to do with the fact that we've all, you know, with the front line anyway, Mick, myself, and Ronnie, especially, been, you know, working probably more constantly and consistently for the last 3 years than you would if you were just with the Stones, which tends to be a sort of stop and start operation. You're always like just getting to the peak. And you say, yeah, we're just pushing now, we're just getting over there and we're going to see another big peak. And everything stops for 2 years. And then you start again at the foot of the mountain and like try and crawl your way back up. And just as you get there again, it all stops again.
I thought it was unlikely because everybody was getting so involved in their own projects, me included, that it didn't seem time that when everybody would be free at the same time to do anything. But we had a meeting last May, not the May gone, the one before that, and decided that if everybody got all their solo stuff finished up by the end of last year, then maybe we could do an album, and if the album was done quick enough, we could do a tour. And so it happened, but the first objective was to get Mick and Keith together again to write songs together instead of independently, as they've been doing over the last few albums. Keith's been writing his songs, Mick's been writing his, and they've been doing them. And Keith hasn't liked Mick's songs, and Mick didn't like Keith's songs, and it got a bit confusing as they're the producers.
One, two, one, two. Stones have made some great records, and everyone will know that it isn't easy to make great records. A few people here, close to the Stones, will know that sometimes it isn't easy to make records at all.
Just wanted to make a record, finish it by the time we got the tour going, you know, and I didn't have fantastically high hopes to make a totally exact record, something that you would be totally precision. I knew it was going to be pretty rough at the edges. But I wanted some variety. When we were writing it, I was very aware that I wanted it to have some different strains in the music than just the previous Stones album.
It worked, you know, from the minute we got in there, Mick and I started to come up with sounds, and it's funny about that guy. If he's just in a room if we're in a room together, just by ourselves, and we can review some of the hassles and just crack up, you know, we're rolling on the floor, you know.
Who do you think you are? Mick Jagger.
It was very, when I first came here, it was very conformist. It wasn't done at all to be nonconformist in any way. You were vilified for it. I mean, physically, verbally, lashed if you wore slightly different clothes or looked slightly different. I think now that this is the great country of individuals and individual freedom, you know. But I think now people are slightly more open-minded than they were.
When we first started off in the 60s, there was a lot of spoken camaraderie, you know, never mind unspoken. There wasn't a lot of competition. We'd kind of help each other get record deals and hang out together in clubs. I mean, we were each other's best friends.
We were great friends. We always were friends. They were friends of ours before we made a record. They came to see us in a little club, and they put the word round to various people that there was a really good band in the Station Hotel Richmond, which was a pub, back of a pub. And it was through them doing that that we got discovered, really.
They struck me, they stood out, and I liked it when I first saw them. I think that's basically any fan of the band had the same reaction. Just like the music and like the image.
This band was never set up to try and set the world on fire, you know. It was almost the opposite, was it? It's too uncool to be popular, you know. We were like, you know, into being hip, you know, all that stuff, you know, when you're a kid, you know. Jesus Christ.
It's amazing that we're all out at the same time. The Ringo, too, you know, you I don't know why, because we didn't plan it. There must be something in the air, there must be something in the water or something. Because just this year, I announced that I was going out, and everybody else said, well, yeah, they're going out, and the Stones are going out, all the kind of guys we know in the crews and stuff are all getting booked up. It's great, I don't know what it is. It's cosmic, man.
My aim in life was never to be a pop star. I enjoy it with reservations, but I'm not really sort of satisfied. I have no sort of concrete ideas in the future because I really don't know when things are going to come to an end or what's going to happen.
Mick Jagger is probably the best live performer there's ever been, I would think, in rock and roll.
I see him change daily, so he never surprises me now because he always does unexpected things, you know.
He's a mixture of different peoples. He's a bit like Peter Sellers. He is. He's one day is one kind of Mick, and the next day is a different kind of Mick, and that evening is another kind of Mick. But he's still Mick.
Well, Mick and I, what can I say? 41 years after we met. In that respect, I just say this. We just work together, you know. I mean, working together, there's something that Mick and I have an understanding of a certain kind of music.
He's not a genius thing, it's a horrible word.
Well, Keith's like a gypsy, really. A pirate. He lives like that and he plays like that.
He's obviously a lot older and tamer than he was, you know, because you just can't be, you know, what you perhaps would like to be. So you have to sort of calm down a little bit. I think that having two young children that he's got now sort of calmed him down somewhat.
Just a great little band. They've been together long enough to make a real good noise. Mick's a pretty good showman up front, you know. They have a good time. And they're a legend. You know, I like the Stones. So good band.
It would be a shame if it stopped operating, you know. So as long as it's still going, the music's getting better.
The Rolling Stones are still looking for the Rolling Stones. Yeah, I mean, they don't think they're at their best yet. They might be arrogant and hopeful, or whatever, you can call it what you like, but they still, I mean, the feeling is that there's more in here to be found out yet, that we haven't, you know, got the final juice out the grape yet.
We go to the end of this year and then we see what happens.
A whole new country.